Yesterday on Breakfast, we talked to the principal of Manaia View School in Northland about how much they do to keep some of their families afloat. Breakfasts, lunches, milk in schools, fruit in schools, stationery, grocery vouchers, you name it. This isn't a crisis of caring. There is so much caring there. It's a crisis of income, homes with not enough of it. This morning, the Child Poverty Action Group will release a major report into how much some household income falls short of their outgoings. Now, some of you will know this story. Some of you have told us about it. You're living it. The CPAG report comes out at 10 and it looks at what's called income inadequacy, even after increases to benefits, which come in on April 1st. That's this Friday. This is important and we want to preview it this morning. To help us do that, we're joined now by Andrew Hubbard, Deputy Chief Executive of the Citizens Advice Bureau, to discuss how the government can step up and help families, as he puts it, live a life of dignity. Andrew, it's really lovely to have you with us on Breakfast and thanks for coming to the Wellington studio. Mordena. What citizens' advice? Thank you. What citizens' advice seeing? So, what are people coming to you about?
I mean, we see, the reason why I'm here this morning is really because we see every day the impact of an income inadequacy on people who are reliant on income support. So we see a whole range of things and the really difficult position that people are put in because of the lack of adequacy of income. So I think of an example of that we dealt with earlier this year with a mum who wanted to buy school stationery for her kids. And just because the income's so tight, what happens is she spends the only discretionary income she has, which is money she'd normally spend on food, to buy stationery. And that's why she contacts us, because she needs emergency food support. And unfortunately, we're seeing more and more of that sort of situation where people are so, there's so little buffer for the circumstances that happen in life that they then are forced to give up the little discretionary income they have, which is often actually paying for food in order to pay for other things. And we also see kind of the perverse impact of the income inadequacy of income support. For example, you know, a really common situation we see is people who, for instance, you know, their car breaks down. So they use the car, take their kids to school, go to their part-time job, visit their elderly parents, breaks down, and there's just not enough of a buffer that they can afford to pay for repair. So instead, they get a loan from a loan shark and put them in a spiral of even worse income inadequacy.
Yeah, and I think there will be people watching this who know exactly what you're talking about. And the example of the car breaking down and suddenly, or not passing your warrant, right, and suddenly needing to come up with $300, $600 or $800 is just a panic attack for some households. This is what you're talking about. This is what the CPAG report that's coming out at 10 o'clock today is about. Now, I don't want to prefigure that because there's an embargo on it, but what you've all done and what this report importantly does is use the welfare expert advisory group modelling around income, right? So it says this is what households in certain circumstances are going to get. And what you're all saying and what you've been saying at Citizens Advice Bureau for some time, and in fact you were part of the open letter to the government with the Fairer Future campaign at the end of 2020, simply saying it's not enough. If you do the maths, we can see that many households in New Zealand don't have enough money to pay the bills, right?
That's exactly right. So the Welfare Expert Advisory Group did a fantastic job of modelling what was a livable income for income support. And what CPAG's done as part of the Fairer Futures Coalition is to update that modelling to take account of the increase in inflation and the cost of living. And that clearly is going to show that income support just doesn't meet the requirements of a livable income. People are totally stretched. And I think you'll see when the figures come out later this morning that there's a really big gap for some people between what is a kind of a minimum livable income and what income support provides. And so we're calling on the government to increase core benefits up to that livable level as a first step in ensuring that income support actually works for people. Because we simply shouldn't have an income support system where people are having to rely on emergency food from food banks in order to get by in day-to-day life, or having to turn to loan sharks. Or the other thing that we're really concerned about is the level of debt to work and income to MSD as well, which again just seems like a totally perverse situation that people are having money taken off the income support to pay a debt they had to get from income support services to pay for the day-to-day things of life.
None of this, I need to point out, none of this is outrageous or provocative or controversial, because the government convened the Welfare Expert Advisory Group, gave it its terms of reference, got a report back from the Welfare Expert Advisory Group saying raise benefits by precisely the level you're now talking about, and hasn't done it. They have raised benefits, and we're seeing that again on April 1st, but is it enough?
No, it's simply not enough. And that's, you know, there's quite a big gap now because of inflation between what the Welfare Expert Advisory Group recommended and what income support levels will be even after the increase. And we're also really concerned about the cost of living for people on disabilities as well. So we see a lot of people struggling who are on disabilities, and the disability allowance is really quite minuscule and doesn't cover the real needs of people on disabilities. I think of a client we dealt with recently who had come out of hospital with a serious health condition, and they live some way from the hospital, so they're having to drive to hospital a few days a week, and they just couldn't cover the cost of petrol. So you've got someone who's facing a major illness who's basically having to use a food bank to get by because they need to pay for petrol to go to the hospital. And that simply shouldn't be the way that our income support system works.
Andrew Hubbard from Citizens Advice Bureau, previewing, I guess, this report from Child Poverty Action Group, the Child Poverty Action Group that's coming out at 10 o'clock today. Andrew, we really appreciate you joining us, and we really appreciate the work that Citizens Advice Bureau is doing. I know that you will see people in some distress increasingly regularly, so thank you for coming this morning, and thank you for giving a damn about the people. I see you smiling at me, but I really mean it. Thanks, Andrew.
Well, and I just thanks to all our volunteers. We've got 2,500 volunteers around the country who are dealing with these sorts of situations every day.
Thank you. Actually, I'm just going to do a shout out to your volunteers. If one of them's watching and they want to tell us about some of the stories they're hearing without giving away people's identities, email us breakfast@tvnz.co.nz. Andrew Hubbard from Citizens Advice Bureau. Thank you so much.